cosmetic fantasy and sci-fi.
We are everything monster.
Just cleaning the old table here. It's served me well for years. But alas, the xenomorphic termites have gotten to it. Oh, don't worry. They're just called that. They're harmless. Well, for the most part. Now, this is much better. Combining the craftsmanship of elves and dwarves yields remarkable results. Just don't let them know you're working with the other. And finding a dragon carcass was no easy feat either. Before we dive headfirst into where the earliest conceptions of a cycloptic monster actually hail from, spoiler, it may be older than ancient Greece itself. I have to shout out our first ever 5 patrons as they mark the start of a new era of World of Monsters. Thank you Christian, Toby Larone, Brianna Spears, Raincrawler, Dante Cofield. You are amazing monsterites that will never be forgotten. And if you want to see the awesome tiers and goals of the army, check out our Patreon. It's all right on the front page there. And now, I know, this monster is long overdue. Cyclops, we honorably welcome thee. I'm assuming you've heard of or caught hints of the Greek background to the Cyclops, and if you haven't, we'll get to that too in a moment. Because you see, that is not necessarily the furthest back in time we can discover the or a Cyclops. Enter the Isin-Larsa period, circa 1961 to 1699, before Common Era. We find ourselves in the Kafaja Temple, near the Diyala River on the eastern outskirts of modern-day Baghdad, Iraq. On the wall there is a terracotta relief depicting a warrior slashing at a curious figure with a pointy, single-eyed head. Henry Frankfurt, the director of the excavations at the temple, admitted they did not know of who these representations were, though in 1936 proposed that the monoculus, monos meaning alone or only, and oculus meaning eye, was a fire demon due to what appeared as sun rays radiating from its head. Henry was possibly the first to identify the being as a precursor to the famed Greek Cyclops creation of a much later era. Eventually, archaeologist Yigal Yadin pointed out the similarity of the scene in the plaque to a Babylonian poem of creation, recognizing it as Marduk, Babylonian king of gods, killing Tiamat, a sea goddess. As other theories came to pass, rejections also rose, proposing that the seemingly cycloptic feature is a gaping wound rather than an eye. Then came René Labat, who, through rigorous research of Babylonian diviner tablets, discovered relationships between ancient Sumerian terms and Akkadian words that would translate into monoculus. The text within read of the god of war and pestilence, Nurgle, slaying Igitala. Igitella, when digging deeper into the phonetic differences between the two languages, logically matched Igidili and Igidilu, which define as monoculus. Therefore, the Sealand Dynasty tablet has revealed the story of Nurgle defeating a one-eyed being, a monoculus. A cyclops? The mystery of whether this monster was part of a race or an individual entity is still unclear, but even though the time gap between the modeling of this intriguing Babylonian relief and fabrication of the Greek Cyclops may seem like 1,000 years, we now have knowledge that transmission of written scholarship to eastern coasts of the Mediterranean were quite active throughout this time. Hence, it is very likely that the Cyclops of Greece did in fact have a Near Eastern, or as designated today, a Middle Eastern ancestor. For details on the study, look up Nurgle and the Babylonian Cyclops, an article written by Andrew George of the University of London, published within the 69th Journal of the Bibliotheca Orientalis. The Greek Cyclops concept certainly may have been inspired by the Mesopotamian monoculi, although would it have really been that far-fetched of an original conception, considering the other monstrosities that emerged from the rising civilization? That really does bring to mind just how many of the monsters were genuinely original. Cyclops, deriving from Greek to Latin, kuklos, meaning circle, and ops, meaning eye, kyklops or cyclops, being the equivalent of circle or round-eyed, cyclopes, plural. The ES, probably added after the Cyclops word, worked its way into French, Italian, and Spanish, where the S was replaced by an E, Cyclope. When it comes to the Cyclops of Greece, we are greeted with a couple notable variations that inspired further works, one of Hesiod and the other of Homer. It's still debated to this day which came first, as both Homer and Hesiod lived within the same time frame. So alphabetically, let's begin with the Cyclopes of Hesiod's poetry in Theogony: Argus, meaning bright; Brontes, thunder; and Steropes, lightning, were divine blacksmiths and among the first gods within the mythology, for they were the sons of Uranus, god of sky, and Gaia, goddess of the earth, and brothers to the hundred-handed giants, the Hecatoncheires, and younger brothers of the great Titans. The three enormous single-eyed brothers were very powerful beings, and like the Minotaur, our first monster video ever, were brought into quite an unfortunate existence. The father kept all the brothers imprisoned within their mother's belly, the depths of the earth, as he felt much hatred for the monstrous children. Encouraged by his mother, youngest of the Titans, Cronus, was joined by the Cyclopes to overthrow Uranus. Upon victory, Cronus turned on his brothers in fear of their might and imprisoned them, along with their younger, many-handed brothers, in the Greek underworld of Tartarus, where they worked under Hephaestus, the patron god of all artisans, craftsmen, and artists alike, in his forge under volcanic Mount Etna. Campi was a female human reptilian monster that was assigned to forever guard the entrance against any escape of the Forsaken Brothers. Let's pause here. This is the story or part of a compilation you may have found online. For you see, Greek mythology is a fickle beast. It's so old and all over the place that the summaries you often read nowadays are inaccurate or compositions involving parts from many writers and storytellers into one usually more entertaining piece. Therefore, here is the rest of Hesiod's tale, summarized but as true to his poem as I could find. Having the brothers entombed, Cronus now proclaimed himself ruler of the gods, and with a growing anxiety of having his power put at risk, swallowed his children whole as soon as they were born to imprison them within. Eventually tired of losing her children, Cronus was tricked by his wife Rhea, and their son Zeus was spared, as instead Cronus swallowed a clothed stone. This great son of Cronus himself eventually grew up and forced his father to vomit out the brothers. Note, gods were often imprisoned like so due to their immortal nature. They just could not be killed. Once free, the Cyclopes and Hecatoncheire brothers rebelled against their Titan siblings. With Zeus in the lead and in gratitude, the Cyclopes gifted him with a great weapon that would be a prominent aid in defeating Cronus and the other Titans, the Thunderbolt. After their great victory, Zeus was established as ruler of the cosmos. Again, this was Hesiod's poetic tale, a tale that has been embellished and expanded upon by the likes of Callimachus, Euripides, and Virgil, who were mostly poets, and Apollodorus, a scholar who presented quite a different retelling of the whole. For instance, the detail mentioned earlier of the Cyclopes working under Hephaestus was an addition made by both Apollodorus and Callimachus. The mentioning of the monster Campi was most likely Apollodorus, and the Mount Etna distinction probably came into being when these and later poets began merging sources from Homer's and Hesiod's tales. This is akin to how in the 80s you would have read a Marvel comic that would later go on to being transformed into a motion picture with some lore modifications, and then that depiction being further modified into a movie that you may have seen recently. Even this production will be remade or may influence a future reiteration which will continue the endless cycle. Just imagine the sort of retelling of Spider-Man people will get 100 years from now, and how many. So let's continue with this hybrid of a story, now influenced by several persons over a frame of roughly 200 to 300 years. Let's find out how the Cyclopes story was ended. We'll backtrack a little to Mount Etna, where the monster Campi stood guard. Same as presented earlier, due to his mother tricking Cronus into swallowing a rock instead, Zeus survived, hidden away until he was ready to overthrow his father. He destroyed the Campi, releasing the Cyclopes and their Hecatoncheire brethren. In return, the one-eyed brothers forged thunderbolts for Zeus, a trident for Poseidon, notably known as God of the Seas, for the ruler of the underworld Hades, the Helm of Invisibility, and more such as arrows, bow, and quiver for Artemis, the hunter goddess, all of which was used to defeat Cronus and the Titans. They also created an altar for the gods, which today can be seen as the constellation of Era and the great Cyclopean walls that I'll cover more in a bit. Still, the Cyclopes had not earned their break. For soon after came Asclepius, Apollo's son who knew the deepest secrets of healing. Zeus, fearing he would reveal the mysteries of resurrection to the humans, struck him down with lightning. In infuriated retaliation, Apollo unjustly slew the Cyclopes, for they were the ones that had fashioned the lightning bolts. And for this, Zeus banished Apollo, his son, from Olympus to serve a mortal at his home and land. And so ends the tale of the three Cyclopes of Hesiod's writings. Let's see if Homer's were offered a better fate. Before jumping into today's relevant portion of the Odyssey, let's introduce these Cyclopes and Cyclops of interest with a prologue written some 300 years later by Philocenus of Cythera. The monocular humanoids here are a race described as unintelligent, vicious, full of pride, who continually plundered their neighbor, the Phaeacians. These giants share a similar description to those of Theogony, apart from being incredibly gifted craftsmen and, well, much less godly as they lived within the realm of humans. Roaming within the caves of Sicily upon steep mountains, they lived a savage life of disorder, exercising no fear of the gods as they saw themselves above them. Hierarchy was present within families where the male dominated, and thus, perhaps upon the lands were the bigger and stronger ruled territories, though that's just my observational suggestion. Interesting enough, as lawless as they were, they still had certain respect for the belongings of one another. They had no skills in particular and relied on the land to supply them with wheat, barley, vines of wine, and the land very generously did. But there was one among them that was different, that herded his own sheep and lived apart from the others. Poseidon's son, Polyphemus, was the most famed monstrosity here. Polyphemus was a towering gobbler of men who had fallen in love with the most beautiful sea nymph, like his mother, Galatea. She, on the other hand, was lovers with Acis, the son of a nymph and famous faun. When Polyphemus discovered them together, he crushed Acis with a boulder. In her sorrow, Galatea turned the streams of her lover's blood into the Sicilian river, Acis. And so in heartache, this telling ends. And albeit a much newer lore addition, it nicely segues to possibly the most famous story of the Cyclops, a work of Homer's. One day, while Polyphemus was out and about, a ship arrived with a group of men, the leader among them, Odysseus, a growing legend at this time. In their innocent ignorance, they found shelter in a large cave abundant with food. Upon finding the intruders, Polyphemus sealed the entrance to his home with a huge boulder, trapping the sailors and thereafter eating a few of them. Overnight, Odysseus came up with a plan to get the Cyclops too drunk to stay on his feet, making his precious eye reachable. He offered the Cyclops some wine, which the giant never had before. Odysseus observed the foolishness of the monster as they proceeded to chat. When Polyphemus asked for the leader's name, Odysseus replied, "Nobody." For the wine, Polyphemus promised to eat Odysseus last and finally fell asleep in his inebriated state. The warrior then found a wooden stake that he hardened and shaped in a fire and thrusted it into the Cyclops' eye, blinding him. When Polyphemus cried for help, the other Cyclopes arrived and soon left when he yelled to them from within his cave that nobody had tricked him and that nobody had attacked him. After a while, when Polyphemus finally decided to release his sheep to graze, unknowingly, he freed his human captives as well, as the men had fastened themselves to the bellies of the animals, avoiding any of the above inspections by the giant's hands. Odysseus, in a moment of pride over their victory, revealed his true name to the Cyclops from upon his ship. Father Poseidon, hearing his son's curses, was not at all pleased at this, and thus a decade-long grudge against Odysseus began, complicating the hero's voyage home much more. The men barely escaped as stones hit the waters around them from the powerful hurls of the furious giant. You can imagine where the inspiration for being named the Cyclopean Islands came from, for these islands upon eastern Sicily's coast. Other writers created more original tales, while some merged the worlds of the ones mentioned earlier, making Sicily the island home for both the Cyclopes of Hesiod and of Homer. The landscape and the surrounding sea conveniently fit the tales, creating a pleasant, distant home for all of the monocular giants. The primordial cycloptic masons were also believed to have built the burly cyclopean walls of Tiryns, Messenia, and Argos. They were assembled from stacks of stones, many of which were much too heavy for one or four men to lift. Dating possibly as far back as 2000 BCE, there isn't too much cyclopean lore surrounding them, and the structures remain somewhat a mystery to this day, especially when comparing the newer build styles to those of the Incas of faraway South America. The internet is full of flawed information on these topics, and while I try to filter in the best facts into the correct context, it is very time-consuming and tricky. One just doesn't find information on a Greek monster, but rather finds themselves soon to be a student of the intricacies of Greek mythology and literature. Even though the terms Cyclops and Cycloptic have become synonymous with describing a being as having a single eye, this is where our presentation of the history of the actual Cyclops conception nears closing. For there are many one-eyed monsters that have inhabited various folklore since ancient times, and they each deserve their own deep dive into. Here are just a few that may pique your interest. Not long after the creations of Homer and Hesiod, the Arimaspi, a Scythian tribe of one-eyed people that battled griffins, arose from the poetry of Aristaeus. From Irish mythology spawned Balor, a malevolent giant with one massive eye that brought upon destruction when opened. Would be a great alias for Marvel's Cyclops. This one-eyed Panoti? Panoti were a mythical race of people with enormous ears found in Scythia. From Japanese mythology, we get a good number of supernatural cycloptic yokais. Hitotsumi Nyuro, Hitotsumi Hozo, Hitotsumi Bo, and the very strange Ipondatara, to name a few, with an honorable mention to Shirime. Don't worry, you're seeing that right. And from the Philippines, the Bungisungis. In short, the giggling cyclops with the interesting detail of possessing tusks. Which could make a lot of sense as we round our way back to the monoculi term on this very old map of Africa. Among the more famed notions of how the Cyclops and possibly other single-eyed humanoids came into human belief, we find the elephant skull theory. In his 1914 publication, Die Tiere der Vorwelt, Austrian paleontologist Othniel Abel discusses how elephant skulls in Sicily may have been misconstrued as those of Cyclopes. Elephants in Italy, one might ask. Yes, but not those of the New World species, but of a prehistoric type known as the Sicilian dwarf elephant, whose many a fossil had been discovered in the caves of Sicily. Upon inspection of the skull fossil, such as with most proboscideans, one will find a huge cavity at the center area of the skull. That, as proposed by Othniel to the layman, could appear as if it were a socket for a large eye, when in fact, it was where the elephant's trunk connected. While some scholars deny that ancient Greeks fathomed this belief upon finding the skulls, or that they even found them, it does hold some merit when just earlier I mentioned the monoculi of Africa, the land of the largest elephants alive today. How about the tusked Bungisungis of the Philippines, where Asian elephants weren't introduced until at least the 16th century, but thousands to millions of years prior to that, Stegodon luzonensis roamed the lands, leaving their mysterious fossils behind. It's a solid theory, but let's take a quick gander at what other possibilities there were. The cycloptic blacksmith relation is often brought up as an inspiration by actual blacksmith who wore an eye patch in case one eye got injured with a spark, the other remained healthy and operational. A rational approach, and in combination with the elephant skulls, a solid basis for the birth of a monster. Cyclopia, a word that would ring a bell here for any teratologist, is a congenital disorder where the forebrain doesn't properly develop, with a single area for the eyes rather than two, even though it is highly uncommon and as an abnormality, inconsistent in appearance. Accounts of it span hundreds of years. The possibility of one living alone to adulthood having this disorder sometime in our history is barely believable. But an entire family or group of people? Again, not likely, as cyclopia occurs in about 1 in 100,000 newborns, most of them stillborn and the others passing away soon after. Could these defects have been more common in a particular area at a particular time? In short, yes. The native to Italy and other parts of Europe, hellebore was an herb sparingly used to induce regurgitation. It was found that upon ingestion in greater amounts, it could cause physical defects in grazing animals and in humans, one of which was cyclopia. Therefore, in archaic times, numerous miscarried human and animal babies with a deformed face and merging or merged eye socket could have stimulated or further supported an opinion that this was supernatural in nature and possibly the work of the gods. And then we have the ancient aliens theory, which would have most likely involved some major organized cover-up. Possible? Sure, but to our knowledge, not very much so. And peering over our living monoculus skull of World of Monsters, I'd like to give a shout out to Max Zorro, who was the original creator of the sculpt behind this inspiration. You can find him all over the place like Facebook and Instagram, but I recommend you delve into his brilliant work on his Etsy page. He's truly a very skilled, creative individual. Thanks, Max Zorro. Now, maybe more important than trying to figure out who or what inspired the Cyclops in the Greeks are the lessons and symbolism entwined within the poems of antiquity. In Homer's telling, the Cyclopes had no manners. When greeted by strangers in his home, Polyphemus did not receive them kindly and offer them comfort, as was the Greek custom, for one never knew if a stranger about was a god in disguise. The Cyclopes had no respect for Zeus and the gods, and so were looked upon as savage and uncivilized, something no one wanted to be called. No one wanted to be compared to the likes of a Cyclops. The representation of the one-eyed beasts may also be a figment of who we are. As Edward Sylvia, philosopher, explores, it could be the self-centered, narrow-minded part within us that limits our vision of self. The limitation of having one eye, seeing things only one way and not allowing oneself to perceive themselves from other viewpoints. An interesting approach to keep in mind when delving into the various sides of Greek mythology. As with the Cyclopean walls, the giants were also associated with megalithic observatories, constructed to help measure the movement of the celestial bodies. Therefore, maybe there was some relationship between the single eye and the visual portal of the telescope. Hesiod's representation of the monsters was, in a way, almost opposite to that of Homer's, as their description can more easily be associated with the Cyclopean walls, for these primordial Cyclopes were expert craftsmen, understandably enormous in size, for they were gods. And as in Egypt, figures of such importance were always depicted as bigger than any mere man. Why then were the Cyclopes of Homer gigantic? Was it because of the discovery of the elephant fossils that outmeasured anything human? Or was Homer's poem in fact influenced by Hesiod's, proving who was indeed first to tell an undying tale of the Cyclops monstrosity? So many factors could have inspired and brought forth the Cyclops. It could have been as simple as a deformed fetus or story convenience, or the amalgamation of older Sumerian tales combined with strange fossils and architectural findings. Whatever the case, simplistic a creation as the Cyclops may be, it is truly a fascinating monster and entirely worthy of its fame. Also worthy of their fame are these blessed individuals of Patreon who greatly helped me get through everything necessary to get these videos out to you. Thank you, Cloud, Christian, Dante, Rain, Ramin, Rihanna, Tammy, Toby. Thank you all. Monsterites, please like for the efforts, and if you're not a Monsterite, then subscribe right now, and if you want to see what other strange stuff I'll be covering soon, be sure to click that bell button. It's supposed to help. But if you can't wait and you enjoyed learning about the Cyclops, you may want to watch this video where I cover pretty much everything one can about the Gorgons, you know, like Medusa. Also, here is a video hosted by Dogdanza explaining what the Japanese yokai are, in case you were wondering during that earlier mention. If you're interested in monsters from movies or even video games, then you're almost in the right place, as we've got all that covered on our channel too. Just head over to our channel page and get wild. And if you'd like to sponsor a Bigfoot family threatened by hunters, join our Patreon. And remember, as always, links to the concept arts in the video will be in the description. I have been and will continue to be Monster Master Arthur. See you in the next one. Hopefully the Gorgon one. Or the one about Mayan Quetzalcoatl. This one was for you, buddy.